Good morning, my dear student. Today, I will discuss with you your next division of your concern syllabus, that is pterophyta. As you know very well, in pterophytes, there are four divisions mentioned in your syllabus. One is the psilophyta, second is lycophyta, third is spinophyta, and last and advanced division of your concern syllabus, that is pterophyta. Today, I discuss with you your advanced division of your concern syllabus, pterophyta. It is also known as phylicophyta, or it belongs to class Pteropusida. The members of this division are highly advanced nowadays. They are dominant on Earth at present. This is the one of the most advanced groups of the fern on land at present scenario. As you know very well that except this division, the pterophyta, lycophyta, and spinophyta, the member of these division are not advanced in characters, in as a living being. But the member of this division is so advanced, and they are mostly the member of this division are living. This division near about having 305 living genera, and there are 10,000 species have been reported by pteridologists. The member of this division especially found in Himalaya ranges. Near about 400 species have been reported by pteridologists on Himalaya ranges. So before the life history of the Ophioglossum, because it is the first member of the pterophyta division, pterophyta in your syllabus, before studying the Ophioglossum, we have to know about the diagnostic features of the division pterophyta. It is my prime duty to discuss the diagnostic and character features of division pterophyta before study the Ophioglossum. If we are talking about the origin, according to geological record, it has been observed by pteridologists that these plants appeared in the post-Carboniferous period of the Paleozoic era. As you know very well, that the Paleozoic era considered as age of pteridophyte on land. They were dominant on the earth during the Carboniferous period. So they are known as the Carboniferous period is also known as the age of fern. They are represented in much greater number in the modern age. Many of the modern fern had their representative in Mesozoic era according to geological time scale. So mostly member of this division are reported as living, and there are some pteridologists who worked on this division are Hogue, H-O-G, Bose and Shukla. They worked a lot of research on the member of this division. This is the introduction to this division. Now I am talking with you the diagnostic features of this division. There are some specific diagnostic features have been reported by pteridologists, which are very unique in this division, not in unique in other division, which are number one, mostly the member of this plant, the plant body of this division is sporophytic. which is differentiated into well-developed root, stem, and leaves. The leaves are so differ from other member of the division that the in other member of the division of the pteridophyta, the leaves are not large. But in pterophyta, mostly leaves are large. The leaves have unique property of in this division. The leaves perform two unique work. Number one, photosynthesis. Number two, reproduction. So in the member of the pterophyta, the leaves perform a very specific property. They help in a photosynthesis as well as they help in the reproduction. But in other member of the division, the leaves perform only one function, that is the help in reproduction. A little bit rate of photosynthesis take place by the leaves in other member of the pteridophyte. The leaves may be simple, mostly lobed, pinnately compound. The leaf blade is so deep, they reach up to the midrib. So they are pinnately compound leaf. So in member of this division, mostly the leaves are pinnately compound. Sometime in some member of this division, the leaves are palmate compound, palm-like. In some member of this division, the stem is underground and present in the form of rhizome, which is creeping upright and develop aerial shoot. On the basis of the leaf morphology, you can easily identify the genus of the pteridophyta. So the morphology of leaf play an important role for identification of the pteridophyte. In the member of this division, the sporangia develop in groups. They are remain inside a very specific organ that is known as sorus. The presence of sorus is the character features of the division pteridophyta. Sorus is not reported in either division members of the pteridophyte. Mostly in aquatic fern, which concerned with this division, sorus is present. The sporangium in the category of this division having a very special cells in the form of annulus and stomium. At the point of stomium, the sporangium become ruptured. So stomium cells help in rupturing the sporangium. The development of sporangium may be eusporangiate or leptosporangiate. The development of sporangium in such a category of fern is eusporangiate and leptosporangiate. Majority of the member of this division are homosporous. As you know very well, what is homosporous? The plant which have the produced only one type of spores is known as homosporous. But some member of this division have been reported as heterosporous. Azolla, Marsilia, Pilularia and Regnaldium. These genus reported as heterosporous. What is heterosporous tendency of the fern? The fern which have the potential to produce two different shape and size of spore in microsporangium or megasporangium individually. As you know very well, in heterosporous fern, there are two different shape and size of the leaves are developed. The smaller one is known as microsporophyll and bigger one is known as megasporophyll. On underside of the microsporophyll, there is a developed microsporangium in which a lot of microspore are developed. After rupturing, these spores follow suitable substratum and they become germinate and produce male prothallus, on which male gametophyte and 3DM is developed, in which male gamete in the form of anthrozoids are produced, which involve directly in the fertilization. Same here, on megasporophyll, there is a develop under surface of the megasporophyll, megasporangium, in which, remembered it, in which a few, near about 4 to 8 megaspore are developed. And by rupturing the megasporangium, megaspore become free and fall on a suitable substratum. And in the same manner, they become germinate and produce female prothallus, on which the female gametophyte Archegonium is developed, in which egg cells is developed, which directly participate in fertilization along with the anthrozoites, along with the male gamete. After fertilization, there is a production of the zygote, and after development of zygote, there is a embryo is formed. Remember it, in case of pteridophyta, seed is not formed. Seed is not formed. So they are non-seeded first vascular cryptogamous. Remember, majority of the fern are homosporous, but there are 9 genera pteridophyte have been reported as heterosporous. Mostly out of 9, five genus pteridophyta come under this division. Pteridophyta. One is Salvinia, which is aquatic fern. Azolla is a common name is mosquito fern. It is the smallest fern. It is also aquatic fern. Marsilia, it is also aquatic fern, Pilularia and Regnildium. These 5 genus of the pteridophyte come under pteridophytes, come under heterosporous tendency of the fern. So, in case of homosporous fern, mostly the prothallus, which is known as gametophyte unit, which are monoecious, on which both males or females same process. So these are the diagnostic features of the pteridophyta. And in case of heterosporous, always prothallus are dioecious. Separate prothallus, there is a developed male and female source. Prothallus mostly monoecious or dioecious, but dioecious are rarely. In case of heterosporous, mostly dioecious prothallus is developed. The Enthridium, which is male gametophyte, and Archegonium, which is female gametophyte, are usually embedded or partially embedded in prothallus. Mostly anthrozoids or male gamete are multiciliate. They have multi numbers of flagella which help in locomotion from one place to another for fertilization. The embryo does not have suspensor cell because they are the lower category of the plants. Presence of suspensor represent the higher category of the plants. So this is the diagnostic features of this division. Now I want to discuss your first order of your syllabus, pteridophyta, that is ophioglossales. The member of ophioglossales is so advanced. In order ophioglossales, there are only 3 genera have been reported by pteridologist. One is ophioglossum, which mentioned in your syllabus. Second is botrytium, which mentioned in your lab course. And third is helminthostichia. There are 3 living genera come under the disorder. Now I will discuss with you your genus of order Ophioglossales, that is Ophioglossum. The common name of Ophioglossum is adder tongue fern, adder's tongue fern. Yaad rakhna bachcho, adder tongue fern. Because the fertile spike of the plants resemble with the tongue of a snake. Due to this, the common name of this plant given to adder tongue fern. First of all, before studying the description of this plant, we have to know the systematic position of the plant. It belongs to group Pteridophyta, division Pterophyta, class Pteropsida, order Ophioglossales. It is a very important order of your syllabus. It is also important for external exam. Ophioglossum is so important for external exam. It belongs to family Ophioglossaceae. Genus is Ophioglossum and family is Ophioglossaceae. If you are talking about the distribution, it is widespread and cosmopolitan genus that achieve luxurious development in the tropic, mostly Himalayan range. A few species of the Ophioglossum have been reported in temperate zone. Mostly the plant body of this plant are terrestrial, and some species of this plant reported as epiphytic. They grow on a large tree as epiphyte plant. For example, Ophioglossum palmatum and Ophioglossum pendulum. These are the epiphytic species of this genus. The terrestrial species grow well in soil where humus is so rich. So this is the habit and habitat of the Ophioglossum. Some species of Ophioglossum, such as Ophioglossum vulgatum, have been reported in growing clay soil with mixture of sand. They are common Indian species. The Ophioglossum vulgatum is so common, which occur in India. The latter species frequent bank of rivers, streams, pools, ponds, and other water sources. It has been reported from many places, especially in the northern India. Some species of the Ophioglossum have been reported from northern India, and which is very dominant in Chamba to Sikkim, ascending up to 9,000 feet. The species of Ophioglossum have been reported up to 9,000 feet. If you are talking about the external features of the plant body, before understanding the external features of the plant body, we have to see the picture, we have to see the diagram of the this is the picture of Ophioglossum. If you see the picture, this is the plant of Ophioglossum. The plant is sporophytic, which divided into well-developed roots, reduced rhizome. This is the aerial shoot. And at the apex of aerial shoot, there is a fertile spike is developed. There is a unique features of the plant body of Ophioglossum is, In one season, in case of Ophioglossum, there is a develop only two to three leaves. There is a develop two to three leaves. The leaves are so large, green, photosynthetic, and they help in photosynthesis as well as in help in reproduction. This is the petiole of the leaves. The apex of the aerial shoot having a group of sporangium in the form of syningium, in which spores are produced. The ophioglossum is homosporous pteridophyte, in which similar shape and size of the spores are produced. The fertile spike of the ophioglossum is very similar to tongue of snake. That is the reason behind it. The ophioglossum is known as adder tongue fern, the common name of this fern, given to on the basis of the structure of the morphology of the fertile spike. Fertile spike is so similar to tongue of snake. From reduced rhizome, towards lower side, there is a developed adventitious root which penetrate into the soil and absorb, and the main function of root is absorption of water and minerals from the suitable substratum for growth and development of the plant. And on the margin of the aerial shoot, there is a developed 1 to 2 leaves in the season. If you see the fertile spike, if you cut the ILS of the fertile spike, you can see on both sides of the main axis of the cone axis, it is also known as cone. Cone is not formed in this division. Sorus and in case of ophioglossum, when the sporangium develop in group on the both side of the petiole tip, the sporangium develop in group, which known as fertile spike. If you cut the LS of the fertile spike, you can see under the microscope that on the both side of the cone axis, there is developed sporangium in which a lot of spores are produced. So the photosynthesis performed by these leaves. This is the external features of the plant. If you are talking about the root are adventitious in nature, which develop from the rhizome towards the lower side. It may be the branched or unbranched. They don't bear root here because root here mostly absent in the lower plant and present in the higher plant. And the pteridophyte group is the lower plant. So root here mostly absent in the case of ophioglossum. And they are heavily infected with the endophytic fungus. The root of the ophioglossum mostly infected by the endophytic fungus. If this relation remain fail, the root, when not affected by endophytic fungus, the growth of root will be checked. There is no proper growth of the root take place in such a situation if this situation remain fail, because there are some fungus remain inside the cells of the root and provide the raw material for proper growth and development of the root. If you are talking about the leaf of the ophioglossum, the sporophyte may be monophyllous. It may be the plant which have one leaves, or polyphyllous. Sometime in some species of ophioglossum, there are more than two leaves developed in a one season, but mostly one leaves developed in one season. This is the unique features of the ophioglossum. Mostly one or two leaves develop in one season, but in some species of the ophioglossum, more than two leaves develop in one season. So they are known as polyphyllas. Ophioglossum vulgatum is so common Indian species, very popular species which occur in India, mostly in the northern Himalaya. Only one leaf unfold during one growing season, but two or even three leaves have also been reported. I have discussed already with you. If you are talking about the stem, some portion of the stem remain inside the soil in the form of rhizome, which is usually short, cylindrical, and radially symmetrical, and upright organ. The stem in the case of Ophioglossum remain twofold. One is the rhizome, which is the underground portion of the stem. From rhizome, there is a develop towards lower side a large number of adventitious roots which don't bear root here. And the main function of root is absorption of water and minerals. Mostly the root may be branched or unbranched. They are mostly brown in color. And the rhizome is so much reduced. And towards upper side from the rhizome, there is a develop aerial shoot in the form of petiole. And on which in the one season one leaves is developed. At the apex of the petiole there is a develop fertile spike in which is four spores produced which help in reproduction. So fertile spike is a reproductive organ of the Ophioglossum. So this is the external morphology of Ophioglossum. Now, I want to discuss the reproduction. How the reproduction take place in Ophioglossum? As you know very well, that in fern reproduction take place by spore, and mostly spores are produced within a very special structure known as sporangium. And the sporangium develop always on ventral surface of the leaves. The leaves which involve in the development of the sporangium known as sporophyll. As we know, the Ophioglossum is homosporous. And in case of Ophioglossum, because Ophioglossum belongs to the higher division of pteridophyte, that is pterophyta, the spores produced within a very specific structure. Sometimes it is known as syningium. If you are study the xylotome, which belongs to xylophyta, the spore producing organ is known as syningium. So the this character of the Ophioglossum is very resemble with the xylotome. This character presence of syningium. But in case of Ophioglossum, the spore producing organ known as fertile spike. So the fertile spike, the fertile portion of petiole, which produces the sporangium, is a reproductive organ of the Ophioglossum. So in case of Ophioglossum, spore produced within a very specific structure known as fertile spike. And the fertile spike of Ophioglossum is very similar to tongue of a snake. That is the reason on the basis of the morphology of the fertile spike, the common name of Ophioglossum given to adult tongue fern. I repeated many times in my lecture. The spike is a specialized segment of the leaf because you know very well in case of Ophioglossum, the leaf perform two functions. The member of the division pteropyta, the leaves play an important role. The leaf play unique features in this division. the leaves play two role here. One is the photosynthesis, second is the help in reproduction. Same here, in case of Ophioglossum, the fertile spike develop at the margin of petiole. The mature spike have lower sterile cylindrical portion called as stalk or the peduncle. The stalk is situated attached to the base of lamina of the sterile leaf on ventral surface, ventral side. Always the sporangium develop on the ventral side of the sporangium. If you are talking about the structure of sporangium, the completely embedded sporangium may be spherical or oval in shape. It has a several layered thick wall. The innermost wall layer function as tapetum. The tapetum play an important role in a sporangium. It is also known as kitchen of the sporangium because the cells of the tapetum have the proper amount of the carbohydrate, protein, amino acid, lipid, fatty acid, minerals, vitamins, etc. So it is known as kitchen of the sporangium, and they play an important role during the sporogenesis. At the time of the spore formation, they provide food material for proper development of the spores. The cavity of the sporangium filled with a compact mass of spore mother cell. After development, these spore mother cells produce spores. Now we have to know how the spike as well as sporangium develop in Ophioglossum. The development of spike and sporangium has been studied by Bower very well. How the spike develop, how the sporangium develop in the Ophioglossum. The development of sporangium along with the fertile spike is eusporangiate type. I discuss in many lecture that the development of sporangium are of two type. One is leptosporangiate type, second is eusporangiate type. On the basis of development of sporangium, the fern has been classified into two categories, leptosporangiate fern and eusporangiate fern. In the leptosporangiate fern, when a single cell, concentrate on it, when a single cell of the leaves involve in whole development of sporangium, when a single cell known as sporangian initial cell, when involved in whole development of the sporangium is known as leptosporangiate fern. On other hand, in case of eusporangiate type, when a group of, remember, concentrate on it, when a group of cells of sporophyll known as sporangial initial cell involved in the development of whole sporangium is known as eusporangiate type. The eusporangiate type tendency of the fern represent the higher category of the fern. Because of, in case of the gymnosperm, in case of the angiosperm, the development of sporangium is of eusporangiate. So this character resemble with the higher plant. In case of Ophioglossum, the development of sporangium is of eusporangiate type. So it is very advanced and higher fern. You may say that Ophioglossum is advanced and higher plant. How the sporangium is developed? So this diagram indicated the development of sporangium. As you know very well, the development of sporangium always develop on ventral surface of the leaf. So in ophioglossum, the development of sporangium is of eusporangiate type. It is a unique type. What happened? Below the leaf blade cells, a strip of cells, a group of cells, a strip of cells, which is initial cells, after developing, they produce the spores along with the sporangium. A band of, a strip band of cells, a group of cells, which known as a sporogenic band, involve at initial stage in the development of sporangium. Now this sporogenic band cells undergoes a vertical division, and produce large number of sporogenous cells after repeating vertical and anticlinal division. This single layer band cells after anticlinal and periclinal division produce large number of sporogenous cells towards inner side and towards side, outer side, jacket initial cell. As you know very well, I discussed many times with you, the outer jacket initial cell after various division, after anticlinal and periclinal, always produce sporangium wall. In which outer layer of sporangium wall known as always epidermis, which protect the spore mother cell from outer environmental factor. And towards inner side, in case of ophioglossum, there are developed many archisporial cell or sporogenous cells, which differentiated directly after repeated division, directly spore mother cell. The sporogenous cells directly differentiated after various division, produce spore mother cell. And thus it is a sporangium of the ophioglossum, which developed from a strip of the leaf blade, which known as sporogenic band. After periclinal division, they produce the outer initial cell and towards inner side sporogenous cells. The jacket initial cell are after anticlinal and periclinal, repeated produce sporangium wall. The innermost layer of the sporangium wall is stem layer. The cells of the tapetum have proper amount of carbohydrate, protein, lipids, vitamins, etc. They provide time to time this food content to the spore mother cell during the sporogenesis. What sporogenesis? Remembered it. The development of spore from sporogenous cells is known as sporogenesis. The formation of spore from sporogenous cells is known as sporogenesis. So this tapetum layer is known as feature of the sporangium. Clear it is. One to layer, middle layer are also present here, is sporangium. After maturation of the sporangium, due to developed turgor pressure, the sporangium wall become ruptured at the time of maturation. When the sporangium become matured, the sporangium ball become ruptured due to turgor pressure. As a result, all the spores mother cells become free and fall on suitable substratum. As you know very well, the spore mother cell always diploid in nature. But after dispersal, after fall on the suitable substratum, they undergo the reduction division, they undergo the meiosis division. As a result, they become spore tetrad. From one spore mother cell, there is a develop four spore daughter cells. And all the four daughter cells remain together in the form of spore tetrad. So before germination, remember it, it is a very interesting one, diagnostic features. Always before germination, all the four daughter cells become separated one other and in on suitable substratum, in favorable condition when moisture is available, they become germinate and produce monoecious prothallus. Because of Ophioglossum is a homosporous form. If you see the sporangium, in sporangium, all the spores are alive, same shape and size. So Ophioglossum is a homosporous form. After germination of spores, there is a developed prothallus. There is a developed prothallus. So before studying the prothallus, you have to know how the developed prothallus. Always, prothallus is developed after germination of spores. After germination of spores. What is prothallus? Because of the spores is haploid in nature. So prothallus is haploid in nature. In homosporous form, always prothallus is monoecious, on which male and female sex organ, that is the antherium and archegonium, develop on the same prothallus. So prothallus is a multicellular, made of parenchymatous cells, multicellular, green, photosynthetic in nature. They are haploid in nature because they develop from the haploid spore. That is the reason behind it. The spore mother cell, before germinating, undergoes reduction division. So in nature, you know very well, always sex organ are haploid in nature. Antherium is so haploid, archegonium is so haploid. So reduction division is so essential before germination. What happened? It is a spores which having a single nucleus in the center and surrounded by outer layer exine and inner layer is intine. Exine is so thick, smooth, rough, and intine is so thin, elastic in nature. What happened? In presence of moisture, they become germinate. First of all, the exine become ruptured and intine come out. Now a transfer wall division take place in the spore. As a result of due to transfer wall division, there are formation of two cells. One form towards upper side known as upper cell, one form towards lower side known as lower cell. Now towards lower side, in lower cell, a vertical wall division take place. As a result, three cells formed here. At this stage, the spore known as three-celled gametophyte. At this stage, at three-celled stage, there is a interesting one events take place. The spore get infected by fungal hyphae. There is a symbolic relationship between the fungal hyphae and spores. The fungal hyphae affected the spores and they remain attached with the spores during the development of the gametophyte. They provide raw material for germinating the spores. So the fungal hyphae indirectly play an important role during the development of prothallus because of they provide the raw material, excess raw material. So in presence of fungal hyphae association, the development of gametophyte is so well. If this association remains failed, it has been observed by Bower, because the development of the sporangium, development of the gametophyte have been studied very well by Bower. It has been reported by Bower that there is no proper development of the prothallus take place. Sometime it has been reported by Bower that sometime the spore become abort. There is no development of prothallus take place in absence of this very well association. So remembered it, the spores of ophioglossum, the prothallus of ophioglossum always remain inside the spore. So association of fungal hyphae with the prothallus is the unique features of ophioglossum. If you see, after this stage, what happened? Now the three-celled gametophyte, here three-celled spores undergoes further division, and end of the day they produce multicellular prothallus, which known as gametophyte. All the cells of the prothallus have the potential to produce sex organ. Because the ophioglossum is homosporous. So the prothallus is monoecious in nature. You can see that the male and female sex organs develop on the same prothallus. The antheridium mostly distributed throughout the entire surface of the prothallus. And the archegonium and archegonia remain embedded within the cells of prothallus. The archegonium, you can see the archegonium, it is the archegonium which has egg cells, and it is a mature antheridium in which a large number of male gamete or antherozoids are produced. And some cells of the prothallus develop rhizoids, which remain inside the soil. And they absorb the food germ material for proper growth and development of the sex organ as well as the prothallus of the ophioglossum. And you can see is a mycorrhizal fungus. You have been observed in the cells of the prothallus of ophioglossum. So it is an interesting one features that the prothallus of ophioglossum always get affected by fungal hyphae, which provide the extraordinary raw material for proper growth and development of prothallus. So it is a classical question in case of ophioglossum that the spore as well as the prothallus always get affected by mycorrhizal fungus, the fungus which remain association with the spore as well as prothallus. Prothallus is multicellular, green, photosynthetic, monoecious in nature. They also provide the rhizoids which absorb the water and minerals from the suitable substratum. Now we will discuss the story, how the develop prothallus from spores. Ophioglossum is a homosporous fern which provide similar shape and size of spore, which germinate give rise to bisexual prothallus or monoecious prothallus or gametophyte. Prothallus is also known as gametophyte because Gametophyte are the structure of the plant which develop the gametes, male and female gamete. If you are talking about the morphology of the spore, they are produced in large number and are visible as small. They are sometimes appear yellow, dust-like particle. They are so you can see under the microscope only. They are microscopic in nature. You cannot see with naked eye. They are tetrahedral in shape and possess two-layered. Outer layer is exine, which is rough, tough, and spiny, or known as exosporium. Thick होती है, sculptured होती है, spiny होती है. The inner wall is thin and elastic, gate होती है, known as endospore, endosporium or intyme. How the spores is germinate? The germination of spores of some species of population have been studied under the experimental condition. There is some experimental has been conducted by teratologist how the spores become germinate. The full detail of germination leading to the formation of mature prothallus are lacking. There is no much more information about the how the spores are germinate, but according to some teratologist, it is considered that in presence of spores, the spores become germinate. What happened? They absorb the water content from the suitable substratum. The result, what synergize in a waste of in time, there is a developed turgor pressure. Due to developed turgor pressure inside the in time, the exine becomes ruptured and in time come out from the by the rupturing of exine. The prothalli of Hyobolosum are subterranean. It means some portion of the prothallus remain inside the soil and some portion of the prothallus remain in air, and may be hyaline, colorless. Sometimes it is brownish color, grayish, yellow in color. They are essentially saprophytic in nature. Saprophytic in nature hota hai, where humus is much abundant in the soil. They are always infected partially or wholly by the mycorrhizal fungus. So this, the association of mycorrhizal fungus is the diagnostic features of Ophioglossum. The association of mycorrhizal fungus play an important role. They are usually lack rhizoids. The size of prothallus varies with the species on the basis of prothallus. The size of and shape of the prothallus in Ophioglossum are very species to species. It is usually ranges between 4 to 12 millimeter. So you can estimate what is the size of the prothallus. So you can prothallus under the surface, under the microscope, always. Dekhi, you can estimate the size of the prothallus is 4 to 12 mm. तो आप सोच लीजिएगा कितना बड़ा है। If you are talking about the sex organ, how the sex organ develop on prothallus, the Anthridia, a group of Anthridium is known as Anthridia, and Archegonia are found on same prothallus. So gametophyte or prothallus are monoecious in nature. In homosporous fund, always prothallus are monoecious in nature and usually occur intermixed. There is a frequent distribution of the Anthridium and Archegonian have been reported by teratologists. They develop a little below the growing apex and develop in acropetal manner. This is about the development of sporangium, development of gametophyte in Ophioglossum. Thank you very much. If you have any question regarding the external morphology, regarding the development of sporangium, regarding the development of prothallus, you may ask me.
ओवर हो गया सर ना.